happy Mothering Sunday. Special love out to all of you mothers, and thank you for all that you do. Obviously, also love to others who can't be with your mother this Mothering Sunday because of lockdown rules. And I know that you're going to miss them, or for those who've lost mothers or can't be mothers, our hearts go out to you as well with love. As we remember all those things that are to do with care and compassion, that all the things that mothers give us, and we celebrate that. And we'll start off just by thinking of the love that flows to us from God with the hymn Love Divine. Long reading today, I've decided to break it into two, and just the way it works. And the first one is actually going to be the second one in the Bible, which is chapter 39. We're going to come back then and look a little bit deeper at chapter 38 and Hezekiah's illness. But the second one starts with the king of Babylon and his son hearing about Hezekiah's illness and sets the scene for what will happen to Israel next.
Isaiah chapter 39. At that time, Merodach-Baladan, son of Baladan, king of Babylon, sent Hezekiah letters and a gift, because he had heard of his illness and recovery. Hezekiah received the envoys gladly and showed them what was in his storehouses, the silver, the gold, the spices, the fine oil, his entire armoury, and everything found among his treasures. There was nothing in his palace or in all of his kingdom that Hezekiah did not show them. Then Isaiah the prophet went to King Hezekiah and asked, "What did those men say, and where did they come from?" "From a distant land," Hezekiah replied. "They came to me from Babylon." The prophet asked, "What did they see in your palace?" "They saw everything in my palace," Hezekiah said. "There is nothing among my treasures that I did not show them." Then Isaiah said to Hezekiah, "Hear the word of the Lord Almighty. The time will surely come when everything in your palace and all that your fathers have stored up until this day will be carried off to Babylon. Nothing will be left, says the Lord. And some of your descendants, your own flesh and blood, who will be born to you, will be taken away, and they will become eunuchs in the palace of the king of Babylon." "The word of the Lord you have spoken is good," Hezekiah replied, for he thought, "There will be peace and security in my lifetime."
The reason for doing this first is there's just some technical notes that it's probably worth noting for you. As much in the hope that some of you might read commentaries or be taking a look at your study Bibles and in there find some comments that are made. So far as we've read through Isaiah, we've noted that Isaiah tended to speak and dictate the word that God gave to him and that scribes wrote it down. Also hinted that there were other editors who compiled. And actually, chapter 38 shows that some of that to us with having a section that's actually Hezekiah's in writing and almost a psalm of Hezekiah. And so what you find is that there's a number working on this letter, on this book. And they include Hezekiah, the scribes, and the editor. And then as we flow on, we step off from this into what happens next. Well, the next big thing to happen to Israel is that they will go into exile in Babylon. And ultimately, as it starts in the next chapter, "Comfort, comfort my people," it seems to be talking about the end of exile. And that will be nearly 200 years later. And so then you get people saying, well, there's a number of people working on this, as with the Psalms, where a lot of people worked on it. Is all this written at one time? Is there possibly more than one Isaiah? And so when you get commentaries start talking about Deutio and Tritio Isaiah, then it's either another Isaiah, another person following on in Isaiah's line and heritage, or even a school of prophets that have been writing and continue to write for hundreds of years. And for others, though, it is Isaiah speaking in his day with the pressure that there was from the Assyrian army, and that either the way that the editors have arranged it looks like it then goes on to talk about those other days, and certainly hints that those who are editing it and were reflecting on it in the future found comfort during the time of exile, or he's prophetically speaking about the future. And the reality is we can't actually fully know which one it is, and that's why theologians love to argue about it, and it comes up in commentaries. But the way that I find useful to approach it spiritually is to say we don't actually need to know because the Bible hasn't told us. So perhaps take Eugene Peterson's approach, which I mentioned at the start of this, where the first section that we've just done is about judgment, though we've noted that in that message of judgment, there are also messages of hope. And the judgment partly is putting alongside the brokenness of this world against God's new future that he's going to bring in. I suppose it's like those adverts that you get for washing powder, where you put the dirty laundry against the clean laundry and you sort of say, ah, God's way is better. This is dirty. And then speaking words of comfort, which we'll come to after Easter and we'll follow through the servant songs. And then speaking words of restoration. And maybe all these words came during the pressure that was on Israel as the northern kingdom was captured and taken away by the Assyrians, and they got even to the door of Jerusalem. Maybe it was written prophetically about the coming exile into Babylon. Maybe it was written later, but we don't need to answer that. What we need to look at is what the scripture that God has given us through the Holy Spirit says to us. And we don't need to worry about what is the province of theologians to argue about in their ivory towers, but to find actually what God is saying to us. And in this particular passage, one of the sad things that perhaps God is saying to us is a word of warning, because it finishes where Hezekiah says, "There will be peace and security in my lifetime." And one of the things I'm thankful for in the church is that there are people who prepare for the future. That's what mothers do. They prepare children for the future. And there's people who prepared the church for the future. They built the church. They adapted the church. They put in the balcony. They put in gas. They put in light, electricity. They built the Narthex and they prepared it for the future. But all too often we can see in our modern world an approach that doesn't seem to think about the future. It says, oh, we can burn our fossil fuels now and we don't need to worry about future generations. We can have all the plastics we want now and we can let the future generations worry about cleaning up the mess we've made. They say, in effect, there will be peace and security in our lifetime, so it doesn't matter about building for the future. But perhaps if we're to take the lesson of mothers and we're to take the lesson of our own history in church, then it's our job to prepare for the future so that the future continues to carry the baton of faith, continues to carry on in the good things that God provides for us. And not learning that lesson for Hezekiah seems to be what has led in part to the Babylonian exile, that he was too free to basically give out all his secrets to Babylonians, and they knew there was a ripe plum to pick in Israel and would later come and pluck it and take it into exile. But for now, we're going to actually focus on the earlier story of Hezekiah's illness and see what God has to say to us in that. And as we prepare for that, I've just asked today's question, which is, can you think of a time when you were vulnerable and how did God support you?
Stuart asked me to say something about my experiences of prayer and the importance of prayer in life and how it helps you to deal with difficult moments in life. And I'm nearly 80, and as you might expect, I've had my share of difficult moments. My father died when he was only 50, and I was 21, and I was the only member of the family left to look after my mother and my grandparents. I've experienced redundancy a couple of times, which is a very unpleasant experience indeed. And of course, many of you will know that I've had the very difficult decision to put my wife into long-term care because she has developed dementia. So how does prayer, how does faith make a difference to all this? Well, I am very split, really. I'm a scientist. My work was in the field of medical biology, especially disease processes. So I realized that just praying isn't going to change a disease process, in most cases at least. I guess there are very rare occasions when a miracle will happen, but miracles are miracles, and not to be routinely expected. Prayer is really about putting yourself into a state where you are trying to align yourself with other people who are in difficulty and with, of course, God. And I would suggest that you can really do two things. One is to pray, yes, you know, dear God and all that. But don't just ask. Listen. And allow the peace of God to somehow seep into your life. And we know that whatever it is that we have to face, it isn't going to be worse than what Jesus had to face. We can also think, and we can think in a way which is God-centered. I frequently do that when, especially in the summer, when I'm doing the weeding. The weeds have a pretty, you can sort of spot them and pull them up, and your mind is fairly free to do lots of other stuff. I often think about things in a way in which my faith comes into the way I'm thinking. We can't always make a difference to how things are going to turn out in any very direct way. But we can make a difference to the way that we cope with it. And I have found that that thinking prayerfully and praying thoughtfully are ways that I can cope better with the stresses that happen. So trust is the main thing that I would ask you to have, and do, even when it's difficult, pray, but think about what you're praying, listen, and think prayerfully.
And so we're going to jump back a chapter into Isaiah 38, and we're going to find that part of this is written about, in particular, Hezekiah and his illness, and part of it actually is written by Hezekiah.
Isaiah chapter 38. In those days, Hezekiah became ill and was at the point of death. The prophet Isaiah, son of Amos, went to him and said, "This is what the Lord says. Put your house in order, because you are going to die. You will not recover." Hezekiah turned his face to the wall and prayed to the Lord. "Remember, O Lord, how I have walked before you faithfully and with wholehearted devotion, and have done what is good in your eyes." And Hezekiah wept bitterly. Then the word of the Lord came to Isaiah. "Go and tell Hezekiah, this is what the Lord, the God of your father David, says. I have heard your prayer and seen your tears. I will add 15 years to your life, and I will deliver you and this city from the hand of the king of Assyria. I will defend this city. This is the Lord's sign to you that the Lord will do what he has promised. I will make the shadow cast by the sun go back the 10 steps it has gone down on the stairway of Ahaz." So the sunlight went back the 10 steps it had gone down. A writing of Hezekiah, king of Judah, after his illness and recovery. I said, "In the prime of my life must I go through the gates of death and be robbed of the rest of my years." I said, "I will not again see the Lord in the land of the living. No longer will I look on mankind or be with those who now dwell in this world. Like a shepherd's tent, my house has been pulled down and taken from me. Like a weaver, I have rolled up my life, and he has cut me off from the loom. Day and night, he made an end of me. I waited patiently till dawn, but like a lion, he broke all my bones. Day and night, you made an end of me. I cried like a swift or thrush. I moaned like a mourning dove. My eyes grew weak as I looked to the heavens. I am troubled. O Lord, come to my aid. But what can I say? He has spoken to me, and he himself has done this. I will walk humbly all my years because of this anguish of my soul. Lord, by such things men live, and my spirit finds life in them too. You restored me to health and let me live. Surely it was for my benefit that I suffered such anguish. In your love, you kept me from the pit of destruction. You have put all my sins behind your back. For the grave cannot praise you, death cannot sing your praise. Those who go down to the pit cannot hope for your faithfulness. The living, they praise you, as I am doing today. Fathers tell their children about your faithfulness. The Lord will save me, and we will sing with string instruments all the days of our lives in the temple of the Lord. Isaiah had said, "Prepare a poultice of figs and apply it to the boil, and he will recover." Hezekiah had asked, "What will be the sign that I will go up to the temple of the Lord?"
The first section of it being how he felt in the midst of it all. And I remember talking to various people about how people have felt they couldn't sleep at times during this year, that they were in anguish, that they were worried about what was going to happen. And so perhaps you too also feel those echoes, or perhaps it's another situation that you've had where you felt in distress, that things were on the edge and that you were under threat in some way. And you know those feelings of lying awake at night and groaning, and the day doesn't look as bright and food doesn't look as tasty. In fact, it may all taste like sawdust in the mouth. And just everything feels as though it's coming to an end, and the end just doesn't seem to come. And slowly your mood shifts and becomes down, and maybe you become anxious. And as a nation, we felt that. We've gone through that sense of crisis and loss and anguish. And we can echo where Hezekiah has been. And then it comes to an end. And Hezekiah senses that God has lifted it from him. And it feels like somebody's taken a rucksack off your shoulders and you can walk again. That the days are becoming warmer and brighter. That food is tasting better in the mouth. That you can laugh and you can enjoy things. Maybe you watch a comedy on TV and you find you chuckle for the first time for a long time. And in that lifting, Hezekiah senses God somehow being alongside him and with him. And perhaps that's the sense of where we are now, feeling things are getting better and brighter and moving towards a more positive future. And somehow God, the God who is with us perhaps silently during our anguish, is there alongside us now. Very much like a parent who's been alongside us, watching us as we've suffered in bed, and then is encouraging us to move as we start to move in the world. And realizing that somehow God is in all this leads Hezekiah to his finish, where he says that fathers tell their children of your faithfulness. And here, especially on Mothering Sunday, I want to say fathers and mothers, that parents pass on to the next generation the hope, the faith, the good things, the uplift that moves them forward, the wisdom that they've gained, and introduces them to God and to knowing what it is to find purpose in our life and hit our purpose rather than miss our purpose in life as we know God and fulfill his call for us in the world, whether that's in commerce or in welfare, whether that's in charity work, whether we find our purpose in what we do in volunteering in church or what we do when we volunteer elsewhere in the world, and know that God has called us to something and for something, and we introduce the next generation to that. And Hezekiah has this beautiful little sort of lament-like psalm that reminds us of the journey that we've been through and the journey that we will go on afterwards, where as we come out of this, we too will have to pass on the message that somehow God has been in this and somehow he's brought us to the other side. And that part of what this can stir us to do is to get back in touch with our Creator, find our purpose and move purposely into the future that God has for us.
Let us be still and draw close to God as we offer up our prayers in faith. Almighty God, on this special day we give thanks for the love and protection of parents for their children, and in particular for the way mothers care for and nurture their families. The last 12 months have been a challenging time for all families, and we give thanks for your gifts of strength and patience to all parents in the important task of bringing up children. We are all children in your family, and you have created us to live in harmony. We pray for your church worldwide, that there may be a greater understanding between those of different cultures and traditions. We give thanks for all the hard work of Bishop Mark and all our church leaders, and we offer this prayer for those involved in the appointment of two new suffragan bishops in our diocese. Almighty God, who sent Jesus Christ to be a cornerstone of your kingdom and calls us to follow him, guide your church by the Holy Spirit to show humility, love and mercy as we seek your kingdom. We pray for those you are calling to be the next bishops of Stockport and Birkenhead, and for those discerning that call. Lead and strengthen them to answer your call. In the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. We pray for Stuart, our vicar, and all involved in ministry roles within the parish, as we look to slowly restart public worship after the latest period of lockdown. Help us to be kind and understanding to each other as we make our own decisions how to navigate through this uncertain time, knowing that you will be with each of us whatever we decide. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Today we give special thanks for our mothers and for the love and care they give. We remember our grandmothers and our godmothers and all who have fulfilled that important role in our lives. Bless all the members of our families. At home, where we are most truly ourselves and seen at our best and our worst, give us grace to be able to both to forgive and be forgiven, and to learn the value of honesty, fairness, and gentleness in all our relationships. We remember those families who have not been able to meet together for a long time, and the loneliness and loss many have felt. We know that you made us to enjoy each other's company and community, and we pray that we may soon be able to see each other again and share time together. We remember those families living in areas of the world where they are facing war or famine, and where mothers are struggling to meet the basic needs of food and safety for their children. Today, we particularly think of those families in Myanmar, where there is an unfolding political crisis, and the impact this will have on the most vulnerable communities, already suffering the effects of the pandemic and the consequences of protracted conflict. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Father, whilst we celebrate Mothering Sunday, we know there are those who find this a difficult time, for whom this day brings sad thoughts and memories. Those who may be grieving the loss of a mother, the loss of a child, or a baby through miscarriage or stillbirth, or struggling with infertility or childlessness. Comfort and heal all those who are struggling in mind, body and spirit. Give them courage and hope in their troubles, and bring them to the joy of your salvation. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Almighty God, we pray for those families where hearts are saddened by the loss of someone close and dear to them. In a moment of silence, we remember those known personally to us. Give them strength in the knowledge that their loved one is now with you in heaven. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Loving God, we trust in your promise to hear us when we pray in faith, and ask you to bless all our relationships in our families, our church, and our communities, so that through our lives we may show your love. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name.
Thy kingdom come.
Thine will be done,
on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day
our daily bread.
Forgive us our trespasses,
as we forgive those
who sin against us.
And lead us not into temptation,
but deliver us from evil.
For thine is the kingdom,
the power and the glory,
forever and ever.
Always by my side.
So we've just done again the song God of the Angel Armies, as much because it fits into the general passage of Isaiah, but also it's one that's new to us, and it just gives us a third time that we've done it, just to help us to become familiar with that. At this point, I'd just like to thank all those who've been involved in preparing the Mother's Day cards and sending them out. Maybe one's arrived with you as we celebrate Mother's Day. And as we finish with our blessing, and in particular in both parts, that sort of sense that about passing on to the next generation, we'll just start with a prayer to thank God for mothers. Lord God, we thank you for our mothers, the care that they've given us. We give thanks for those mothers who we no longer see, and we give thanks for those mothers that surround us. We also give thanks for those mothers that we see around us caring for others, and pray that you will pour your blessing into their lives, and that your love will pass from generation to generation, enriching people in the care that they know. Amen. And so as you go into the world, take the love of God with you and pass it on to others. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you always. Amen. So go and share love in every way you can to everyone you can. Amen.